Crunch time.
Crunch time. I'm starting with 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so the man of God may be fully equipped for every good work. We study the Old Testament because all of the scripture, just like Paul said, even the Old Testament, is inspired by God and is very useful if you want to be thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Amen.
So we need all the scripture to be thoroughly equipped for all good work, so that's why we do the Old Testament. All scripture is inspired by God. We're doing today, taking a living the land, the first section on the Joshua story is actually like an overview of the next phase of the Old Testament. We talk about taking, which is the conquering of the land. We talk about dwelling, living in the land. That's actually like living in, dwelling in the land, having it. And we also look a bit about the leadership of Israel in the ancient times, stuff like that. You all have handouts on your desk, so that'll give you a little writing. Recapping a little bit. Hey, Dora, can I have that screen back? I turn around and sit on top of that. Thank you. You said, I'll give you handouts. You also wrote your Bible for me. And you've got Psalm 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Why do I
have
to say?
Because they are one-sided.
Oh, I'm one-sided. Sorry, that's
me. No, sorry.
I'm sure I did one for everybody.
Have you got two locks on your desk behind you?
So Sierra doesn't really like them, so she can do this to you. Is that right? You're okay with her? Yeah, she's C.
Later on.
Okay. Somewhere around here, there'll be another set.
I guess I've got two.
Okay.
Never mind.
Okay. Recapping, in Exodus, we had them coming out of Egypt. They had a special relationship with God at Sinai, where they got the Ten Commandments, all the laws and stuff. I'm just going to read Exodus. Someone else is going to read Exodus chapter 3, verse 7 and 8. Let's set me Matt. Matt's Bible's on the floor. That's not very good.
A little bit.
Exodus chapter 3, verse 7 and 8. Exodus 3, verse 7 and 8. The main things that will come out of this lecture is the land is a gift from God, but we still have to take it by force. So there's a natural and a spiritual side. God has given it, but we still have to possess it. That's a very common principle. God wants to give us prosperity, but we have to possess it. We will see that the judges and then the kings were like the governing force of the land, and we'll look at it and the difference between judges and kings and stuff like that. Also, in this section, we'll see again the emphasis on the divine warrior. The divine warrior is really powerfully displayed in the book of Judges. First point, the land is a gift from God, but must be taken by force. So it's very clear that God is for them, God's going to do it. And they wouldn't possess the land because they were smarter or more powerful, or their army was bigger, but because God was giving them the land. But that did not remove from them the fact from having to do any fighting at all in the battle. So there's like that balance. It's a gift from God, but we still have to do it. But even though we're doing it, it's not our own strength. We're going to read, and our next reader is going to read Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 7 to 10. they were child sacrificing and all that sort of stuff. Quite very immoral, very and all that sort of their idol worship. Their whole society was based on really bad. So there's a part like you can't ever explain really that it was okay to kill anyone, because surely you could educate them and reform them. But the wildest attitude was that, well, the idolatry was so bad, and they had 40 years extra time to get over it, and they haven't. So that was a final judgment from God. There's a clear emphasis in Duke Joshua, especially at the start, that they had to get the will of God. They couldn't go and do it themselves. They had to actually get the leading of God before they went to battle. Otherwise, they'd be in trouble. So whenever there's a war, there's a very clear thing in the Old Testament that wars were actually combat between the gods, and the people were just like the players in the game. It was actually God versus the gods of Egypt versus God of Israel. That's what's really going on. And here now it's the Canaanite God versus the Israelite God. That's what's happening. And whose God is stronger? And so before they went to battle, the priests would come and offer sacrifices and seek the will of God, and the military strategy came from prophetic revelation, what should we do? And so the priests would say, God has spoken, you should go this way, you should attack this town or whatever. And it was all like that, because it was a spiritual unbelief. And we'll see that, and you read the story, they get it right sometimes and they get it wrong sometimes. That's pretty much how it goes. The judges, after Joshua's invaded the land, we get the judges. Does anyone know the names of any judges?
Probably do.
Surely do, but haven't realised that they're judges. But heroes of the Old Testament. Sean, you must not judge. Gideon was a judge. Gideon. The Lord's with you, mighty warrior, hiding in the well in the ground, turning the wheat, whatever. A few others as well. But Samson and Gideon are probably the two most famous, but there was many judges. They were they basically would have trouble. The judge would rise up as a little military leader, gather an army, kill the signs and rescue people, but then have peace for a while, and then the cycle would repeat. Primarily, half their problem was because they hadn't driven out all the people that they were facing, because they didn't actually fulfill the command of God. That's why they had so much testing and so much falling away. I'm going to turn and read Deuteronomy, chapter 8, 10, 20, the whole thing. I've underlined Deuteronomy 8, 10, 20. So let's just have a quick read of Deuteronomy 8. When you have eaten and you are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands and laws and decrees. Otherwise, when you have eaten and are satisfied, and you build flat houses and settle down, your herds and flocks grow large, and your silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through a dreadful desert and thirsty land with snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of a rock. He gave you manna in the desert to humble you and test you, so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and my strength has produced as well for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth and confirms his covenant with you. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you, you will surely be destroyed. Like the nations the Lord destroyed before you, you will be destroyed if you do not obey the Lord your God. So it's very clear that whatever happened to the nations before them, that's what they could expect if they didn't follow God. And so we see some judges, and that's not a very successful time. We see the cycle, which sounds like your life and mine. We have they come in, they turn away from God, they start sinning. God judges them with hands and arms to their enemies. They cry out to God for help. God raises a deliverer who rescues them. They have miracles and everything gets put right again. And after a while of prosperity, normally about a generation, normally it's a 40-year cycle. After a generation or so, they turn away from God again. And then they start sinning and worshiping idols. And so God brings judgment in the form of invasions and stuff. Then they cry to help, and he rescues them, right? Stop and deliver them, and rescues them, and brings peace back to the land, and then after a while, they come back in. But that's really the cycle that happens throughout the rest of the Bible. So we see it in Judges, and we see it in Kings, and Chronicles, all the way through the rest of the story is that cycle happening. Very similar to, I guess, everyone. We can see that cycle in our own lives. We do well, we prosper, we come back to God, we come back to God again. We do well again, then we prosper, then we fall away. We want to avoid that cycle. That is not the normal Christian life. We don't want to live in that cycle, but it's a cycle that was demonstrated for quite by them. But the main themes, the land is a gift, but it is also a place of testing, faith and obedience, and God is the one who will help us. The judges, we'll cover a little bit more about the judges. They were basically local tribal leaders. So you would have an issue in one town, one area, the Philistines would come in and attack. Someone would get inspired by God, would raise up an army, drive them out, and they would govern that whole area. After they'd made peace, they'd be like the leader. But they were really only affecting within, like, walking or riding distance of themselves. So the people living 100 miles away didn't really know who they were, probably, didn't know much about them. They didn't have any influence over them. After the judges, because the judges were pretty disorganized, we will end up with kings. There was a shift to monarchy. Basically what happened in the ancient Near East, A.N.E., there was, as soon as one country, sort of, everything was tribal, small tribal areas with no real nationwide structure. As soon as one area started to solidify with one strong leader, and you get one king over a reasonably large area, they got powerful. So all the other areas realize that if we have small tribal like organization and this country's big, then they're going to take over very quickly. So all of the countries started to pull themselves together and form national groups, have kings over that formed by them. Well, what that meant was you had stability in the area because theoretically you knew who the king was. He was king over a large area. He had some money to actually build roads and govern the country a little bit, raise an army and all that sort of stuff, which meant you could be a little bit more secure. So that's the trend over time. Israel was one of the last countries to have a king. Every other country had kings first, and they were supposed to follow God and trust God as their king. But after, over time, Saul comes along. He's the first king. The Hebrew words, it's not really king. He wasn't quite a king. He didn't really have a palace and all that sort of stuff. He had an army, and he was like a chief, like a chieftain, a local leader, but really, a full king thing really only happened under David. Saul was like a halfway king. Okay, we're going to read. We want to do a them, us, and me interpretation of. So, that's really an overview of the lecture. We'll look at each one of those books later, but we're going to do a them, us, and me in an Old Testament passage for about this time, just to have some fun. So 1 Samuel 17:45-47 is our passage, and that must be read by Chris, is that right? Or Sean? 1 Samuel 17:45-47, we're going to look at a them, us, and me thing for a minute.
1 Samuel 17:45-47. David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. All those who gather here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's. He will give all of you into our hands."
Awesome. Very good. Okay, so now we're going to look at this passage and do some practice our them, us, and me interpretation on it. So the basic context of the story is... Who's the main players in the story?
David and Goliath.
David and Goliath, very good. And David is speaking, he's what's happening in the story right now. Who is he talking to?
Goliath.
Predominantly Goliath, that's correct.
And also
and the Philistines, and he's telling them all that the time's up.
And he's also speaking to the people.
That's right. Anyone who's listening really, but he's proclaiming that he's about to have victory, yes. So the significance for them of this whole talking about the David and Goliath story in particular passage, the then people, which would be the people at the time, or the people in ancient Israel who read the story, what would they have got out of that story of David and Goliath? And David saying, I'm going to chop up your head, and everyone would know the battle is the Lord's, and that sort of stuff. Have some suggestions of what they might have got out of it?
That thing, you trust in God, God will respond to the Lord.
Yes, of course, very obvious. If you trust in God, he will rescue us from enemies. In particular for them, like real soldiers and stuff, God will help us, God will rescue us. Yep, what else would they have got out of that story? Anything else they want to put out of that story?
It's hard because we know the end.
We know the end of the story, yes. You're assuming that they know the end of the story too.
Oh, are we? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, David was fearless and he didn't believe God. And
yes. Very much, that story showed points to David, David the man.
Yeah.
Like Saul was the king, but when there was a crisis, David was the one that rescued him. So one of the reasons that story is in there is to show us that even that David is God's chosen, holy God's chosen, David is the awesome one. So that would, I would say that would definitely be one of the reasons that they would have got out of that story. Not only does God rescue us, but he rescues us through David. So that's a very important point, yeah? Anything else might be... The only other thing that I get out of that is that for them and the then of every level, David did actually have a fight. David used a stone. It wasn't an example of blow the trumpets and praise the Lord and the enemy come down. This story, he actually took out weapons and went to battle, and even though his weapons were smaller and were less impressive than the enemy's, God rescued him through his action. So they could expect God to be, God will rescue us. When we do what little we have, even if you've only got a stone and they've got a spears, I've only got a stone, that's enough, we've got it.
Yeah.
So that would be the sort of thing that they would say, that would be out of that story. Us as New Testament Christians, how was it significant in the New Testament gospel story? David and Goliath,
okay.
And that, what he said in there, yeah? We can say God is with us like he was with them. Yes. Who was the enemy for us?
The devil.
The devil's the enemy, that's a good call. I would say devil and sin would be the two enemies. Death, sin and death is the enemy. I would say mainly. We're not supposed to be, we don't fight people. We remember we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. So our fight is a spiritual fight.
Yeah.
The wrestling against us, but the last enemy to be defeated is death. Those sorts of scriptures will guide me on who our enemy is. Anything else that we would get out of that story? Anything about Jesus? Always think about seeing something about what's the link to Jesus in the story. That's all. Tell me what it is. The story of David and Goliath. There must be a link to Jesus.
Because David overcame something that
he wasn't. Yeah. Exactly the point. Jesus is the son of David, the descendant of David. More than that, David is an example of Jesus. The main point for an Eastern Christian, Jesus is like David. Goliath is sin and the devil and death. Jesus killed the devil, the overcome the devil. When we fight against the primary, we like to think we're like David and we'll kill the Goliath, but actually Jesus is like David, he's still Goliath, we're like David's brothers. We're standing there going, oh my goodness, I don't know what to do. Jesus comes along and kills the Goliath, and we go, Yahoo. That's the most fundamental analogy, that Jesus is, David is an example of Jesus. He does what Jesus does. He's the king after God's own heart, all that stuff. So a lot of the David stuff we see representing Jesus and who he's done. So that's fundamental point. The other important point that Jesus is actually descended from David. If David hadn't won this battle, if God hadn't intervened, there would have been no Jesus. Because they have to keep the Hebrew people alive until Jesus is born, so the world can get the fire. So we have to keep the blessing of Abraham going. All that stuff has to happen. So the global overall picture is keeping the generations of Abraham going so that Jesus can finally come. But yes, primarily Jesus and David are a parallel. Other things that we get out of this, not as theological, but we definitely see the power of our words as a powerful thing in that passage, right? He's speaking against the enemy. He's speaking up. He's not being intimidated by the last words, but he's speaking out, I come against you. God will give you to me. I will overcome you. He's declaring his faith. And we like these days, we keep a lot of speaking out of faith and bringing it to pass. And that's definitely what he was doing. He was operating at faith level, declaring what he believed. Another interesting part in that story, which is not mentioned in that passage, but when his brother said, you can't do this, he knew he could take down Goliath because God had helped him to be in the mines and stuff. In his everyday work as a shepherd looking after sheep, he'd gone to battle and rescued the sheep with a sling stone, so this wasn't his first fight. He learned in smaller fights and he could be prepared. And so there's a definite principle that we can learn from that. Preparing ourselves in the small things, God will always give us what we need and prepare us in time. So those are some things. The things about Jesus are the main us things, but there's also principles that are like universal principles we could get out of that passage. Significance to me, personal application of this passage to us. Has anyone ever been inspired by this passage sometime in their life? Yes, Sarah. You can overcome things. Like what sort of things? Summary of the initial overview of the section of the Old Testament is Laura, can you click please? Thank you. Very uphill there. Way behind that. It's a gift from God, but we have to play our part. There were judges and then there were kings. That's pretty much what we talked about. What I want to do now is a little exercise. I want to give you all this script passage to read. So, this is a passage of Joshua when he's about to go into the promised land, just before he leads the army. So, let's all read this passage. Now, passage, what we're going to do is, this is the them table, this is the us table, this is the me table. So after reading the passage, look at your cards and work out, is it a them, us, or me, an interpretation of the passage. So the card, it's like a response to something I've got out of the passage. Now, is it at a them level, an us level, or a me level? And the them ones need to go over here, the us ones over here, the me ones over here. But yeah, and put your names on them, because after you put them where you think they go, you're going to explain to me, you're going to explain to us what part of the passage led you to get that revelation. And some of the revelations are actually unsound. So, if it's a then one, it goes to this table. The us one goes to this table. And the me one goes to this table. And we will do it in 60 seconds. And then we'll discuss it. If we don't know, we'll talk about it. God does not endorse violence in the new covenant, them, us, or me.
In the new covenant.
Oh, that's a point right there. New covenant. Shields and colleges to praise God and give them the work. Right? So that you don't need to fight. Violence is outlawed in the new covenant. It's not, I would say it's not a legitimate jump to go from that to say that God doesn't want violence in the covenant. You're making a jump that probably is not really there.
But at the same time, they are going to kill everyone.
That's right. So therefore, that jump is wrong.
Yeah.
Getting that from that is an invalid interpretation. So I told you I put something in the blue.
So it is wrong.
That's wrong. Yeah, I would say that. Well, that's wrong based on that scripture. You couldn't go from that scripture and say that. Okay, over on the them side. March around the city to conquer it. Exactly right. They're getting specific instructions what to do right then. God is the divine warrior. Yes, exactly right. God is the divine warrior. He is the one talking to Joshua right now. Telling him, I'll be with you, I'm going to fight, all that sort of stuff. The army should not wear shoes.
Well, did it say Joshua had gone
fishing? That's exactly right. So, incorrect interpretation. But them, there's definitely a them concept, them level thing. Very good. Okay. Here we go. These are the us ones. Okay. Let's go with victory comes from obedience. Them, us, or me?
Us.
I would put it there. Both of them. I would say that they thought that and we did that as well. You can put that both ways. They knew they had to obey, and so would we have carries through.
When we say us,
New Testament believers. Yeah. So it is us, but also them. And based on, I don't know what part of it, but he was telling them what to do, and as long as it was. Now, look with eyes of faith. Where have you got that from, out of the passage? Would it be me? Possibly. Do you know what part of the scripture would have led us to a thing that says, look with eyes of faith?
Make the whole army give a loud shout, then the wall of the city will collapse.
Yes, that I was that in obedience. I get this one from the angel said to Joshua, the Lord said to Joshua, see, look, I have given you the city. Okay, now he hasn't given you the city. So he's telling him to see something that's not there. Right, so that's how I get this one and I say, that's an us thing. For them and us, he has to do it as well. But look with eyes of faith, because the angel said, look, I've given you the city. And looking at it, I can't see it, I haven't done it.
Yeah.
So that's a faith thing. Okay, Jesus will destroy the fortress of unbelief.
No, I'm saying it's going to be like that.
Well, it can't be them, because they don't know about Jesus, right? So it's going to be us or me. And
we put it like right here.
Yeah, you can write it. Anyway, did you find any part of the story that related to that in particular?
No.
I guess the fortress must be Jericho. So Jesus is the... I would probably make it a me, because there's no clear thing between unbelief and me. I've got an unbelief problem and Jesus will help me. I'd make it a me. God has given birth to sin appointments. Then us or me? It's a mean one, of course it is. A Christian in the USA is not going to get that out of that text, right? A Christian in Nigeria is not going to go, God, it's going to be a sin point when you read that. That's me, right now. Us is not us. Us is all Christians will. We'll get the same thing out of it. Same universal application with everyone. Okay, walk around the property for my new church and claim it. Exactly the same. That's a me thing. You don't have, there's no rule, no theological thing that says if you want to buy land and walk around it. But if I read that and I get inspired to do it, well, I'm responding to them. And we do it all the time. Jesus appeared in the Old Testament. Them, us, or me? It's us. Everyone, every Christian reading that and go, that's Jesus appearing to Joshua. And it's no specific revelation to me here. Nigeria, Africa, Argentina, Perth, same thing. It means the same. Jesus was there in the Old Testament. Okay, what else we got? Joshua hears from God.
Then.
Then. Yes, he is current tense, this moment, told them that Joshua, he's taken over from Moses, you just seen the angel face to face, take off your sandals and holy ground. That's what Moses said. Wow, Joshua's the man. So we can, yes, but that's so we can. So I can, is me. But he did, is them, and therefore that's what we do. If they did, they got that, I could go, Joshua hears from God, so does my pastor. So do I, as we all can, because Joshua did, I can, yeah, that's suddenly become me. Anymore? I can overcome my problems on my own. Me and incorrect.
Yeah.
Nothing in that passage about overcoming problems on your own. Okay, very good. Okay. What's happened to time? Door is up as well?
12:40.
12:40, awesome. Okay, we're going to do Joshua now. Joshua the man. Exodus 17, 9 to 14. Let's read that. Sounds like a lot.
These slides aren't
on Moodle. These slides aren't on Moodle? Really? There's two. there were two different flights, A and B. And I've just gone to B.
Oh, you're using the same.
I put them all together. So this is now part B of Josh, Exodus 17, 9 to 14.
Moses, Aaron, and Hur went to the top of the hill. As long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under in the settlement. Aaron and Hur held his hands up, one on one side, one on the other, so that his hands remained steady until sunset. So Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with the sword. Then the Lord said to Moses, write this on a scroll as something to be remembered, and make sure that Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven.
Awesome. So this is one of the key stories of Joshua. When Joshua was a young lad, and they've just come out of Egypt and stuff, and they come and they have this fight, and right back then Joshua was the army captain. And he goes into a fight, and Moses up on the hill, and Moses is praying, they lose the fight, and Moses' hands get tired, and they stop praying, they lose the fight. So there's a very clear thing, who's winning the fight? It's God, through the prayer and worship, that's how the fight's won. But Joshua's on the ground, doing the work, and Moses is like, Joshua, you need to know this, because you're going to be the one that's going to go and conquer. So this is Joshua's training time, to be the hero, to lead the people, understanding that God is with them in the battle and stuff like that. Other cool things that Joshua did, he was the one that went up the mountain with Moses. He like went halfway up the mountain and Moses didn't rest. Moses came down with the commandments. And when they hear noise in the camp, Moses goes, oh, it sounds like there's a fight, it sounds like there's a war. Like, he was obviously a bit of a soldier guy.
Yeah.
And Moses is like, no, mate, sorry, they're partying. Yeah. They're sitting instead of fighting, but it's close. But, the other time we hear Joshua is Numbers 14, 1 to 10. Let's read that, Numbers 14, 1 to 10. Joshua, pre-Joshua. Here we go. Got to be quick around here.
That night, all the members of the community raised their voices and wept aloud. All the Israelites grappled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, if only we had died in Egypt, or in this wilderness, why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. It wouldn't be
It wouldn't be better for us to go back to Egypt. Egypt?
Yeah.
How do you express it? Sorry. And they said to each other, we should choose a leader to go back to Egypt. Then Moses and Aaron fell face down in front of the whole Israelite. Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of who were among those who explored the land, tore their clothes, and said to the entire Israelite assembly, the land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into that land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone, for the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. But the whole assembly talked about stoning them. Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of the meeting to all the Israelites.
Awesome. So there's another story. This is Joshua at his best. Again, you know, the people that come back from exploring the promised land, but all the spies are going, oh, it's too hard, you can't do it, the giants in the land, and they're all going to want to go back to Egypt. Joshua says, no, come on. Again, you see them looking with eyes of faith. Their protection is gone. God is with us. We'll take it over. He's a real faith man, and he's the one that's bringing the good report. When everyone else is bringing fear, he's coming in faith. So that's really, that's who he is. Before we get to Joshua, that's his background, before we get to Joshua. Now, if you're interested, I reckon the story happened about 1405 BC, or around there, plus or minus 100 years. Here's our timeline. This will be right on the border coming into the promised land. This is what Joshua is all about. It's the point of conquest and invasion and stuff like that. There's three parts of the book. First, they conquer the land. Then, they divide the land up among the tribes. And then they actually start living there and get ready to live in the land. That's really where we're going. The conquest part's the interesting part. For us, the rest of them will probably find it tedious. But the conquest part is the fun part. So, the main parts. Joshua, we've only got to look at Joshua. Joshua, chapter 1. Oh, I'm going backwards. Joshua, chapter 1, verse 6 to 9. This is a famous passage. We all love this passage. Because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their forefathers to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the left or the right, that you may be successful wherever you go. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so you may be careful to do everything in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified, do not be discouraged, for the Lord God will be with you wherever you go. So we all love that, be strong and courageous passage. That's the first words really of God to Joshua. God to Joshua. When Moses had died, come on, now you're the man taking over. So the very, again, be strong, be courageous, stick to the law, follow the word of God, stick to what God says, be obedient and you'll surely be successful. So we get, like, we love that passage. Be strong and courageous, meditate on the law, keep focused on the word of God, and you will surely be successful. Joshua had the moments of encounter in the past that brought him to this point, ready to go. After this, so they went, they crossed, first thing they had to do was cross the Jordan, and this is like a rerun of crossing the Red Sea with Moses. They, the priests walk out into the river, and as soon as they walk out into the river stops, and all the water just piles up in a big pile. Well, at the dry land, so all the people can cross the river, just like they did when they came out of Egypt, they do it again, crossing the Jordan, and then when the priests, everyone's gone past, the priests walk back, carrying the Ark of the Covenant, they walk off, back on the dry land, and all the river comes through again, just like the same, so it's a rerun of the same thing, different river, etc., but same thing. So again, all that reinforces the people that this is the same God with them, same miracles are happening, Joshua really is taking over from Moses. They make a big pile of rocks to tell everyone of what God has done. Then they do two things to renew the covenant. They, all the males are circumcised, which is a pretty dumb thing to do that they have to go to war. But they're about to go to war, they just cross over into enemy territory and then they do that. And then, of course, again, remember it's obedience to God that matters, because he's the one that's going to give the victory, and it's not our own or our own wisdom. And then they celebrate the Passover, which they hadn't really done in the wilderness. So now they have the big Passover festival, celebrate the, which is what God had told them to do in the book of Leviticus and stuff. They do all that to prepare themselves. And there's a lot of talk, you know, we are the Lord's people, we will obey the Lord, we will do what God has said, we're ready to go with you, all that sort of stuff. Yeah. Then we've got some maps of where they went on their conquest. The most famous conquest, of course, is Jericho. Now, the brief story of Jericho, who wants to tell us how the Jericho battle went?
Oh, that's much around the
city. March around the city, then what happened?
The walls fell down, they went in, slaughtered everyone.
Oh, well, first they blew the trumpets, and then the walls fell down, all by the power of God, chucked the walls down, that's right. So they killed everyone? Is that true? They didn't kill everyone? Who did they kill? One person. And her family. Rahab, the prostitute, and her nun. While they're spying out the land, Rahab had them in her house. And so she hung a thing in the window of her room so that when they invaded, they all knew to leave not to kill her. And she was counted that basically as one of God's people from then on. And we love this. If you want them, us and me, but us, I don't know what they thought of that, but us, we see that anyone who has faith can eat God's people of God. The whole, well, the way they, like, it wasn't about being sent away from her, God, you became a follower of God, a people of God. It was her faith. And there are a change of allegiance from her own people to God's people that got her into the kingdom of God. And so she's listed the genealogy of Jesus and all that stuff. And it's a great example of faith gets you in rather than ancestry and stuff like that. So what else could we get out of the story of Jericho? Because it was our favorite story of Joshua. Other things, things that we could get out of the story. Yeah, us now, yeah.
Keep praising the Lord and...
Praise is powerful, yes, that's right. Great stuff, praise is powerful. What we have to do, the other thing they do is destroy everything and not take any of the gold and silver themselves. And we can get from there, that concept of giving the first fruits to God, and that's a consistent concept. And we know that what happened, did they offer everything up to God? Did they give him all of the treasure and... Someone stole something themselves, that's right.
Yeah.
And direct disobedience to the command of God, one of the guys, Achan, grabbed a purple robe from Babylon and some gold and silver and took it back to his tent and hid it there because he thought it was just too awesome and he didn't want to let it all get burned up in the fire and stuff.
And
what happened? Everyone suffered. What happened when he did that? Why can't they suffer? The next battle they went to, they got defeated. Because they were no longer in obedience. And so they got defeated. They come back and Joshua's like, God, what has gone wrong? And God says, well, someone has sinned. Someone has touched the devoted things. Someone's taken what was God's and kept it themselves. Over the, so they do. They cast lots. They went through every tribe. They found out which person it was. He came and confessed. And he got stoned to death. And then the blessing came back on the army and brought it again. So the very much the obedience judgment cycle was starting even while they're still debating.
How could God sometimes on
so we pick one person to punish you, is that right?
No, well, like, alright, so when Moses
and Aaron, like, when Moses and Aaron, like, when Moses hit the rock,
yes,
talking to Sarah,
yes,
Moses was affected,
yes,
like, Moses was going to the promised land,
yes,
but then other things, like, except one person, like, this person,
but this one person solves that, and other people go out of battle, and other, they lost the battle because of someone else's sin, is that right?
Yeah, so, like, everyone else is punished.
Yes,
so, like,
that's a good question.
So, like, why does God just sometimes grant them
a trip? Going on in other parts of the world, and it's other people in the world.
Is it up here? Yes. You mean when Moses hit the rock, or when? And the Moses hit the rock story?
In the common Bible.
Yeah.
That most people
on one Jericho place, that's right.
Yeah.
And people everywhere else.
Because if Moses didn't hit the rock, if Moses didn't pop the rock, but then he hit it and no one
God first.
God thought of first.
That wouldn't be fair enough, I would say.
Yes.
I think some things, there's definitely some things are personal, but personal does always flow. Personal does flow on into community. So, in that case, because when it comes to a community going to war, spiritual blah blah, if there's one weak point, you're only as strong as your weakest link.
Yeah.
So, if one person's got sin, the lesson taken off, then by the fact that the lesson is removed, they're all now liable for trouble.
Yeah.
And you can see that in a similar way, like if God, say God wants to bless Centre Point Church, but five people aren't tithing, would it be none of us would be blessed, or what? Like, it's complicated. But in the, there is a spiritual dynamic where unity is required, and like purity and stuff, to advance against darkness. And if the darkness has a foothold, then we can't advance. And so that, I think there's a dynamic of that happens. In the actual confrontation environment, if the devil has a foothold, then he doesn't have to lose the battle.
Yeah.
So I would say that in this case, that sort of thing is happening. But there is a general thing in the world that normally one person does bad, other people are affected. That's actually normal. It's actually unusual for only one person to be affected by their own bad. That seems to be, seems totally unfair, but that's how the world is. Because my good can bless you, while my bad can hurt you. And that's how Jesus' good can bless me. But if any one person's good can influence someone else's good, then one person's bad can affect the bad. So that's the way we live in the world we live in. And that's how God made it, so we... Yeah, okay. Is that fair enough, Sean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think in this case, confrontation battle, if you're not 100%, but if there's compromise, there's weakness, it's the weakest link is the one that will lose the battle. And I would say that in that case, that's what's going on. So yeah, so we've got on the map. They started off, they crossed the river, they went to Jericho, then they went up to Ai and had a couple of goes to win that battle, and then they go north and they start doing their battles. There's a couple of maps of where they go and all the battles. Each one, where they go, where they have their fights, each one has a story. After a while, the stories get a bit boring. They went to this town, they killed everyone, they destroyed it. They went to this town, they killed everyone and destroyed it. There's a couple of mistakes they made. They went to one town and the people thought, oh my goodness, these guys are going to kill us. They've won every battle so far. So they disguised themselves as foreigners from a long way away. And they came along and they said, oh, we've come from a country a long way away. We've heard that your God is awesome. We want to make a treaty with you now so you won't invade us. And so, and it says, and they didn't consult the Lord. They just said, oh, that's a good idea. I guess we are awesome. We'll make a treaty. And then they go right over the hill and there's the whole families and everything and stuff. So now they've made a treaty sworn in the name of the Lord that they won't attack them. And here they are, they just found that they were their neighbours in the promised land. That's what happened next. So then they ended up making them all like servants, but they didn't kill them because they were smart enough to see what's coming. So that's cool. But again, that was your bad. Leaders of Israel didn't consult the Lord, they just went on their own wisdom. What a mistake. So the next thing we get, after lots of battles, is this one here. Once they're in the land, they have to divide the land, who's going to live where. And the tribal thing is a big deal. So each tribe had casting of lots, so Moses told them back in Leviticus how to do it. So now they do what he said. They cast lots for each town, each tribe, and each tribe gets certain areas based on the size of the tribe and everything. The interesting point is that the promised land is officially between the Red Sea and the Jordan River, the Mediterranean Sea and Jordan River. The big red one on the top right is the tribe of Manasseh. That's on the wrong side of the river. And the two underneath it are also on the wrong side of the river. When they got there, they said, this is when they're back through Exodus and Numbers, they said, we've got lots of livestock and stuff, and this is a nice pasture land. Let's live here. We'll go with you and invade the land with everyone else, but why don't we just be out of it? So that's why the deal was done. So their soldiers went through and invaded the rest of the land, but they lived on that side of the river. And that would have been the final tribal areas. It's interesting that Judah's the big round one at the bottom, completely encircled, swimming for some unknown reason. And then the other ones are quite tiny, the smaller tribes are smaller. We've got 10 chapters of how to divide the land from this river to this mountain. And That might spark could inspire reading. Okay. Then we get, once they've settled in the land, the last part of the book is now the starting to live, and there's a big challenge. Because Joshua's about to die, and what's going to happen now, who's going to take over from Joshua? Because that's the difference between leaders and kings. If Joshua was a king, then his son would have taken over, and there would have been a lot of consistency in leadership and stuff. But he wasn't a king, he was just appointed for that one season, and that season's finished, and his time's over. And so there is a controversy, like not controversy, but it's an open end of what's going to happen now. So he gives them a big river, a bit like the book of Deuteronomy from Moses, where he's telling them, you must follow the Lord, you must keep following God, don't turn away, don't worship idols, don't do all those things, all the things Moses said will happen. Two chapters of big speech. Famous passage in that, choose you this day, whom you will serve, as for me and my house, will serve the Lord. That's Joshua, right before he dies, telling people, I don't know what you guys are going to do. You can go back to Egypt if you want to, or serve the gods of Canaan if you like, but me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And they all say, yeah, we're going to serve the Lord, we're going to serve the Lord, we're going to serve the Lord. And two chapters later, in Judges, and they're all turned away. So, that's the thing. There's three people, it's all like a wrap up of the book. Joshua gets buried, Joseph's bones get buried, they came to Egypt. Eliezer, the son of Aaron the priest, he gets buried. And then it's like a whole new generation starting thing. So that's, and then so the end of Joshua is real as a handover to the next phase. There's a lot of parallels between Joshua and, we talk about David being a parallel of Jesus. We'll probably end with this maybe. But Joshua, Hebrew name, is a Hebrew name, that, like Jesus, Joshua, same, like, very similar name, just a different name. Jesus, Greek, Joshua, Hebrew. So Yeshua, Joshua, same thing, you see. So Jesus and Joshua, very a lot of parallels between Jesus and Joshua as well. So I thought maybe we should look at that. Hebrews talks about the whole point of going into the promised land was that people would get rest. And in the book of Hebrews, Paul says, they didn't actually get the rest they were after. It's through Jesus. We rarely get to enter the promised rest of God. The promised land comes through Jesus. So there's a big parallel between Jesus and Joshua. So I thought we should write down some of the things. Parallels between Jesus and Joshua. We've got JJ, how about that? Rest. The idea is you're supposed to get rest in the promised land through Joshua and through Jesus. So, and Jesus' rest is the real rest. But what Joshua's rest was only a promise of what was to come. Can now anyone else think of anything else that would be parallels between Jesus and salvation? And Joshua and Edmund from Saint. We should take on each journey because we've probably talked about most of them already, but common things, parallels between Joshua and Jesus, Edmund from Saint, salvation.
Faith.
Essential. They had to believe to get in. That was faith. Rahab had faith to get. That's what she got saved. Faith. Jesus. Faith is how you
Obedience.
Good idea.
Yeah.
Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So, there's great parallels of, like, a lot of parallels between, another one, what have I written down? The things about Joshua, the key things about Joshua, victory, I would say is important. Joshua led them to victory, and victory, and victory, and Jesus is, with Jesus is the same, we expect victory. But at the same time, the victory is conditional on the obedience. But one of the primary teachings, I guess, one of the big things with this whole parallel is what is the promised land. If the promised land is heaven, then all you need is faith. You need to get to heaven. However, if the promised land is an overcoming life on earth, fulfilling your destiny, all that sort of stuff, then suddenly you need victory depending on obedience, and you need faith. And you need to heed the word of God and everything else, like Joshua's first instruction, continue with the word, do not let it depart from you, and then you'll be successful in everything you do. If that's our promised land, victory comes through faith and obedience, just the same. And my personal opinion is that the promised land is both, but primarily, the promised land really of no relevance to us as heaven, because that's like an easy. The promised land required by us as well. But the other thing that's important, and we get out of this, is the whole concept of, as Chris said, the complete annihilation of the ones that will lead us back to sin. Now, I think, for if we want to be victorious and live in victory all the time, there's a time, especially for new Christians, but there's a diligence to clean out our lives of things that will draw us back to sin. The big problem with people was they weren't diligent at removing the temptation, they weren't diligent at removing the idols, so the idols pulled it away, and when there's compromise, there's no victory. It's only when there's 100% unanimous Jesus, God, and nothing else, that can we get victory. And so that would be another thing, I think, personally, for out of Joshua, the diligence to drive back everything that's of darkness and not give darkness a foothold. As Joel was at our leaders meeting, how many of you at our leaders meeting when Joel talked about demons and deliverance and stuff, right? They used do not give the devil a foothold. When they left the nation's remnants in their city, in their land, they gave the devil a foothold, and that's why they were all powerless and defeated. The importance of not giving the devil a foothold in our personal lives, a very victory comes from faith and obedience to not give the devil a foothold. Okay, we'll do another them, us and me, on one more passage. Do you want to do Joshua 23 or 24? Hands up for Joshua 23. One vote. 24? Yeah. We're doing Joshua 24, verse 14 to 15. I didn't know what it was. 24, 14 to 15. Oh, you got an easy one. I remember now.
Oh, yeah.
Joshua 24, 14 to 15.
Yeah. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. For always the gods your forefathers worship beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites, and whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord.
Yeah, very cool. So, that's our passage. So then, the then meaning on that passage, straightforward. Who was talking?
Joshua.
Who was talking to?
To the community.
To the community of the ancients. What's he telling them to do?
To which one? To choose.
And what are their choices?
Serve the Lord.
Serve the Lord. Or?
The
gods of other nations.
Yeah.
So the gods of Egypt or the gods of the Amorites, who they're living in now, where they are now, or anyone else really.
Oh, yeah.
But make a choice about who you're going to serve, and we're going to serve the Lord. Now, for us, what would that, New Testament believers all around the world, what would we get out of that? Have to tell us about Jesus, have to tell us about following the gospel. Yes, very good. We have to make a choice.
So
we have to choose. We can't serve two masters, that's exactly right. We have to choose between Jesus and someone else. Who else are we choosing? What of us are else? That's the big deal. For us? For them it was very clear. Egypt,
yeah.
Or Amorites, or the Lord.
Money.
What are we choosing? Who are we choosing between? We're choosing money. You cannot serve two masters. Money or Jesus.
Yeah.
That's right. What else? Who else do we want to choose between? Self, that's a good one. Everyone wants to do that these days. Anything else?
Job.
Korea?
Yeah.
Put it down. Love of money is pretty cool. The career of money is pretty close. But there's also fame and all this stuff around there. Yeah, the children. Oh.
Controversial.
Yes. Family. Other religions, we still have that for us today, and more or less we realize people are following other religions, like superstitious about the amount of scientific educated Westerners that believe all sorts of nonsense and into all sorts of stuff is amazing, really, compared to the great scientific age that rejects everything from the Bible but believes in it. Seriously.
Yeah,
and isn't when people come to Christ, we do have to put away that stuff.
Yeah.
Like there's other religions, other idols, stars and that sort of stuff. What else do we got? Anything else? What else we might be observing? That's probably it. Material.
Three and four.
The other thing I'm gonna put down? Addiction. You cannot serve God if you're saved, remember?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. So addictions and, what, I was going to say fears, but issues, like Matt talked about in miracles. If you've got strongholds in your mind that fight over your allegiance, well, they're a foothold that we can't completely serve God until we make the choice I'm not going to serve that, whether it's fear or, I don't know what, you know, issues. The whole point of Exodus, you can't be a slave and to use the same job properly. So choose you this day whom you will serve, and the last 45 seconds we've got left, is it 40 or 45? 45.
40.
We choose who we can serve, and that's, we choose this every day who we can serve. Amen. And let's think about, Joshua leads us to think about who's going to take over next. Who's going to run when Joshua dies? Who's going to lead next? The next generation need to be prepared and ready to carry the fire of God and stuff like that.
Woo!
Great job, Derek.
My time.
Alright, sweet.
My time?
My time.
I like the demo submitting on today.
Yeah. I'm trying to nail that because that's the whole point of the course, really. So we'll keep doing it.
That's right.
Does anyone want to talk about the code of conduct assignment for ethics?